This week on The Gadget Show, we look forward to a summer of sport with our very own Gadget Sports event.
We stage our own gadget version of Euro 2008.
Yeah! We battle it out on the golf course in our gadget-assisted Ryder Cup and finish with our simulated Olympics. And Dallas travels to Switzerland to test drive a gadget bike like no other.
Hello and welcome to The Gadget Show.
This week, Suzi and I are doing gadget sport. By that, I mean any sport that uses a gadget or general gadgets that enhance your sports ability. Anything that goes under the kind of gadget slash sports hyphen category.
Yeah, and with Euro 2008 in full swing and the Ryder Cup following in a few weeks, and then, of course, the Olympic Games, this summer is going to be jam-packed full of sport.
Yeah, so this week, Suzi and I are going head-to-head with our own techie alternatives to Euro 2008, the Ryder Cup and the Olympics.
Yes, and of course, as ever, there can only be one winner. But because it's just me and him, the winner's going to be British!
Hooray! So, first up, the beautiful game. Yep, Halo 3.
Football.
Yeah.
We were at the mighty Burton Albion Stadium for a clash between two footballing titans. It's me and him!
Yay! Oh! Are you OK? Oh,
right.
Magic sponge! Suze, magic sponge, get some ice!
Are you all right?
We've got the three best gadget ways to enjoy football this summer. And to keep us in check, we've got Dermot Gallagher.
He's an ex-Premiership ref who's been in charge of more games than anyone else ever. Dealing with us will be his biggest challenge yet.
First up, it's a gadget classic, table football. And we've got the absolute best. This is the official World Championship table, the Orlando Master Champion. Tails.
Oh, it's tails!
Yeah! I'm going to be blue.
No spinning.
Thank you.
The International Table Soccer Federation choose this table because it's very solid. It has competition leg levelers and even a tempered sand-blasted pitch.
Oh, I think the surface of the pitch is really good. The ball rolls continuously. It doesn't get stuck, does it?
But it's not too shiny, is it? It's a lovely surface for doing your little flick shots on. Oh, like that. Beautifully. The players are made of unbreakable plastic and the steel rods are 50% stronger than standard bars.
The inside of the goals are padded as well, so the balls won't bounce out, causing any unsavoury did-I-didn't-I arguments. Not that that mattered, because it was only me who was scoring. Yes! Yes! It's a goal for Perry! Woo! Woo! I can't see where I'm going! I kicked Jason's butt, and it was on to the next challenge.
You can win more often.
It was a head-to-head battle on what is, for my money, the best footy game around, Pro Evolution Soccer 2008 on the Wii.
It's one of the most innovative uses of the Wii's unique Wiimote control system yet.
All right, Skip. Right, here we go. Using the accelerometer and optical sensor, it registers where you're pointing your Wiimote to control your player and your teammates.
Because you've got so much going on, you know, it's hard to separate your brain, but within time, like literally 10 minutes, you really start to get the hang of it, and it's really, really good fun.
Oh, look! That's a foul!
That's so not a foul!
Yeah!
Back off!
Oh, I can see what's going on here, look.
Back off.
They're related.
Yeah, back off.
You only have to look at their heads to see
There's
that they're
no
related.
Need for that.
Warm me up.
Great work.
I was riled, but I soon got my own back. On the break, I got a corner. Beckham whipped it across and Rooney headed the winner. Woo! Round two to me.
For our final challenge, we entered the world of robotic football. There have been championships held every year since 1995 between universities from all over the world.
We joined the Warwick Uni team for a five-a-side extravaganza.
High five, geek slap. Air resistance.
They aren't radio controlled. All these robots are completely autonomous. We both joined separate teams that had programmed their robots with different strategies. That's how the computer tells their team to react to the ball, whether to hang back until the ball is in their half or go for an all-out attack. We then watched as the battle was played out on the pitch.
The camera above the pitch relays the location of the ball and the robots back to the computers. The computers then decide which robot to send after the ball, as well as controlling all of their movements.
Great shot! And it was our attacking strategy that saw me go 3-1 up with just over a minute left to play. This is better than any human sport I've ever seen, I promise you that.
With a few strategy tweaks, I was convinced we could get back in the game. And my plucky little robots did me proud, pulling it back to 3-2. Then, with seconds to spare, I drew level.
The full-time whistle blew. It was 3-3, but that wouldn't do.
It's going to be golden goal. Whoever wins a toss kicks off.
OK.
You call this time.
Will do.
The first to score would win the game. It was touch and go, but then one of my players burst in from the wing and claimed victory for my team.
No! No!
Yes!
Wow!
I think you'll find that was 3-0.
Oh, it was, I can't wriggle out of it. It was a clean sweep.
Although, I must admit that when I was growing up, I did have a table football and I used to play with my brother in the bedroom.
You were a demon on that game. What about the Wii, though?
That was really good.
Yeah.
Took a little bit of time to get into it, to get it all worked out.
I think the Wii platform has been crying out for a really good footy game like that, and now it's arrived.
But the highlight of the morning.
Absolutely, the robot football.
Absolutely.
I mean, I meant it. It's not just because I'm a complete geek that I said, you know, I like this more than real sport. It was actually really good to spectate, wasn't it? It was really good to watch.
It was really exciting. Well, you could see I was kneeling on the table. I was cheering his goals and my own goals.
Absolutely brilliant.
Time for a break now, but still to come, Dallas test drives a gadget bike straight out of science fiction.
And as part of our gadget summer of sport, Suzi and I head for the tee to test cutting-edge golf gadgets. It's time to return to this week's challenge. Now, you'll remember that we've been looking at gadgety accompaniments to the brilliant summer of sport we've got coming.
Yeah, we've already discovered how exciting and funny robot football is. And I have snuck into an early lead after thrashing Jason in every single football game we've played.
Oh, it's embarrassing. But don't worry, because now I'm staging a comeback. Mm-hmm. Because our next challenge was all about golf. And if there's one thing I know about, it's the old diamond sweaters and nice super bear trousers. All right.
We're great at gadgets, but rubbish at golf. So we became caddies for the course's two pros, Tony and Steve. We'd be trying to help them get ahead with tech. First up, though, we'd need wheels.
Woo! Oh, yeah, that is the way to roll. This is the Segway GT, a golf version of the self-balancing electric two-wheeler. It goes two or three times walking speed, can carry all your sticks, and can cover over 14 miles of fairway on a single charge.
Very nice.
Yeah, that's really great, but it's not exactly the height of comfort, is it? Let's be honest. Tony, wait there. I've got something very special for us.
The Californian Roadster is an 11-horsepower golf cart that can get up to 22 miles an hour. With its alloy wheels, moulded interior and full suspension, it is true golfing style.
That is the coolest Roadster.
First up, the most difficult of all shots, the drive. All right, Steve, here's your weapon of choice.
Thank you, Jason. This is asking an awful lot, though.
It is. There's no head on it, is there?
No.
Don't worry. That's because we're going to be going with the Callaway iMix. It's a build-it-yourself club that's fully customisable. There are 72 different options of shaft and head that can be tweaked to make the perfect club for you.
I've got a different kind of adjustable driver for Tony. Because every player's swing is different, the MP600 has adjustable weights in the head so that you can fine-tune to get a sweeter shot.
Steve was first to tee off.
Go on, Steve.
No pressure.
Go on, Steve. You can do it.
Oh, that's nice. That's straight as an arrow. Right.
The drive was good, but not to be outdone, Tony stepped up.
Shh, no.
Will it perform? Shh. That's all I'm saying.
And his drive was perfect.
You've only gone and done it.
With both golfers having driven straight up the fairway, we now ask them to do the unthinkable, to deliberately play into the rough and lose their balls.
I actually want you to hit it into the rough.
Hit it into the rough over there, please.
Well, if it goes against the grain, we'll try and follow instruction.
Even I could do that.
Lost balls are the bane of a golfer's life.
In the rough.
Smack on.
But we have the kit to find them.
So, to find this errant ball, we've got this ball finder scout gizmo. It's got a little video camera in here, and it should find the ball up to 35 feet away.
When the digital imager inside sees at least three dimples of a golf ball hidden in the rough, it buzzes and vibrates.
And there it is. Perfect.
And the LCD screen shows where it is.
To track our ball, we have the radar golf ball positioning system. The unit sends out a radio signal, which is picked up and returned by a special golf ball.
There's a microchip inside the ball, which apparently is the size of a grain of rice.
The unit has a detection range of up to 100 feet. As you get nearer to the ball, the display flashes and the beeps get louder.
With both balls found, we played onto the green.
It was time for the final challenge, the putt.
And we had two high-tech putters to do battle with.
It's all down to this final putt.
Is that putter?
This is the red-eye laser. It's got an inbuilt laser-guided system, and it is the most accurate putter that has ever been made.
Oh, good.
So you can't fail!
It features a cartridge that emits a laser line from the club. You line it up with this receiver, and a loud beep tells you that you've got the perfect aim.
Hang on a minute. What's that contraption? That's not getting in the way much, is it?
It's just a training tool. You wouldn't be allowed to put the receiver next to a hole in the real game, but it does make for very accurate putting.
I wasn't going to be outdone. I had to give Steve every chance on the final shot.
We've got a lovely piece of kit, OK, the Dix Lite, all right? It's a digital instruction putter.
The detachable head unit logs all the information on your swing and shows up any errors to help you improve. It also has a vibration sensor that tells you if you're gripping too tight.
So the club knows when you've got it balanced perfectly for the shot.
So now, whoever got closest would win.
I'll just man the flag.
Steve's putt just didn't quite have the legs.
Oh, that's good enough for me, though, that.
So Tony stepped up.
OK, do you feel ready with the red eye?
I hope so.
I placed the receiver behind the hole.
That's the perfect line.
I'm in line.
Can you hear that?
I'm in line.
And he putted away. It stopped just short, but it was close enough for victory.
Hey, do you know, that was such a great afternoon. I'd like to learn to play golf.
I'm pleased you said that, because a lot of non-golfers, you know, I like a bit of golf, but non-golfers think that it's a fuddy-duddy sport, and it's not, is it? It's full of really high-tech stuff.
No, it was really, really good afternoon, and my golf pro really loved this Mizuno MP600 driver, because you could adjust the weight and you can, you know, correct your fade or your draw, whether you pull to the left or the right. Really good, he loved it.
But they say that the most important club in your bag is the putter, so no surprise then that my pro, Steve, went for this computer-assisted Dix Lite putter.
Really good stuff. However...
Yes.
You didn't win.
I didn't win.
It was a draw. So it's all to play for in the final round of the challenge. However, now it's time for the focus group. Each week on the focus group, John, Jason and I present the best new gadgets that we can find in a particular category to our focus group, and they tell us which one they like the best. Now, as if you haven't guessed, this week we're looking at DIY gadgets. So we've come to South Birmingham College to find our focus group, and they're all doing courses on... What are you doing, guys?
Carpentry,
decorating, painting, all that kind of stuff. So, Jace, you can go first.
I'm out first.
You are.
I've got a great piece of technology to show you. It's called the Hammerite Metal Master Electrostatic Paint gun. Grab that gun, please. I'll tell you how it works because it's super sexy, all right? You've got some batteries inside there kicking out a serious amount of electrostatic charge. Now, the paint comes out charged by the electrostatic energy. You earth the metal, and then this cloud of paint comes out. The paint, which is charged, is attracted to the earth metal. Now, the amazing thing is that as Simon applies the paint, he's not just going on the front of these metal railings, it's also going on the back. It's a 3D painting machine that uses electrostatic energy. What do you think, Simon?
I think it's a nifty little device and it gets the job done in double quick time.
Would you mind just putting this screw anywhere in that piece of wood for me? What's the problem?
Nothing. It's not working.
Oh, it's really annoying, isn't it, when your screwdriver's got no charge? But don't worry, because this is the fastest cordless rechargeable screwdriver in the world. So if I just put it in its dock here, in 45 seconds, that should be fully charged, because it doesn't use rechargeable batteries. It uses capacitor cells, which means that the charge travels really quickly, so great to use around the home. So there we go, 45 seconds, the little LED indicator has lit up green. Hopefully now it's fully charged and should work perfectly well. There you go, fully charged in 45 seconds. Thank you, Jackie. Thank you very much.
Well, I've got a thing called the Dulux Paint Pod, which aims to take all the tedium out of paint rolling. As you can see, there's no filling up trays and all that sort of stuff and carefully measuring out paint. It all comes in this pot, which drops down into here, and then you plug this thing into the mains, and the paint actually comes up this tube into this thing with a trigger on that you fit the roller. So that just goes on there. And then you've got a trigger in there that activates the pump when you need it and gives you the paint through the roller. But the very best thing about this, I think, basically it cleans itself. So the idea is that when you finish painting, you press drain and all the surplus paint is drained automatically out of the tube. You take the paint pot out of the back and replace it with water. Then you put the brush in back into this container in the front, shut the lid, put the tube back in here, press clean, and over the next 10 minutes, the water gets run through the sponge and all the paint disappears. So the whole horrendous tedium of having to clean paint rollers should be banished completely. So I think it's a brilliant thing.
As well as demoing our gadgets to the focus group, we let them have some time to get properly hands-on to test the kit for themselves so they can make their minds up about what they like the best.
I decorate my house all the time, so I need one of these.
I like it.
You don't have to crawl up and down ladders or stop and start.
Yeah, I think it's really good.
I think it's class the way it can do both sides.
It's a good piece of kit, it's just for those smaller to-do jobs.
It's fantastic.
OK, the time has come. You've got to cast your vote. You've got to decide which of our three DIY gadgets you would like to take home with you, OK? So, if you're in favour of my Metal Master, raise them high. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. OK, good start. What about Susie's 45-second rechargeable screwdriver? 1, OK. And what about John's Dulux paint pod? Raise them high if you're a fan of the paint pod. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Well, we have a winner. It's my Metal Master! Hurrah!
Time for another short break now, but after that...
Dallas tries to test drive a gadget bike like no other.
Hear me roar.
And try to guess what's going on here.
Welcome back. Right, it's time for the top five. And this week, possibly the most fun summer gadget ever invented, the water pistol. Oh, sorry. I didn't know there was anything in it. I've got my hands on 31 of what I reckon are the best water pistols around and devised a few tests to separate the sweet from the naff and whittle down the numbers until we're left with the top five water pistols to buy this summer.
Lock and load, baby.
First up, the distance test. There's no point having a water pistol Woo-hoo! If it'll only shoot a couple of feet. I want one that can take out a cocky neighbour at long range.
You've got to be a man to use this.
So I started by losing the ones that couldn't shoot very far. If the water didn't reach my carefully measured 10-metre mark, it was out. Woo-hoo! And those that did hit the spot...
I love this gun!
..made it through to the next test.
Yep, that'll do, sir. Hey, look at that! That's going to strike fear into the heart of an enemy, isn't it?
19 guns have already failed. That leaves 12 in my arsenal. Next test, power. It's pointless having a water fight if the best your weapon can produce is a tiny jet that wouldn't even worry an otter. So, our 12 remaining guns and Jack holding some crepe paper. It's the power test. You ready, Jack?
I tested the pressure and power of each pistol by firing it at Jack through the paper. The ones that got him wet were in. The ones that didn't were out.
Oh, yeah! That's spectacular!
No way.
Hasn't failed us yet. Well, I've got 5 guns left, but so that I can organise them into some form of meaningful order for my top 5 water pistols, I think we need one more test. Soakability.
It's essential that these water pistols hold enough water to properly drench your target. So for this test, I made my water blue using food colouring. And once again, Jack was my target.
All right, Jack, you ready, dude? Let's do it, shall I?
I was going to find out how much water I could shoot at Jack with just one pull of the trigger. The more water the pistol held, the wetter Jack would get.
Ah, man, look at that. It really doesn't do the kind of soaking that you require. OK.
There we go.
The blue water showed me exactly how drenched each pistol made him. The bluer Jack was, the better the pistol.
Oh! Woo-hoo! Here we go!
Right, job done. Here's the rundown of our top five water pistols. At number five, it's the Water Weapons Blaster. At number four, the Water Blaster Mini Water Cannon. The number three spot goes to the Wazooka Fun Blaster. Number two is the Water Blaster XLR Water Cannon. And at number one, delivering a thorough drenching, it's the tried and trusted Flash Flood Super Soaker.
Oh, you gotta love the Flash Flood.
This one was such good fun.
Isn't it brilliant?
Wasn't this the one that you tested a couple of years ago with the Gurkhas?
The Gurkhas, yeah, and it came out top then. So it stood the test of time.
It's really sturdy, isn't it? I wouldn't mind having a go, you know.
No, I'm a bit nervous you holding that.
No, but
don't
it's
even
really
think
good
about
fun,
it.
Is it? Except for just
no,
to,
don't. No! I don't believe you did that!
Gadget Show new boy Dallas is up next. He's been on his travels again. This week, he's been off to Switzerland, where he's been checking out a very interesting-looking bike.
I've just been having a little wander around the streets of Zurich, and the first thing you notice is it's so nice. It's clean, the streets are organised, everyone's immaculately dressed. They've got these beautiful rows of bike racks. And to be honest, I do feel a bit sort of scruffy and out of place and generally British. But despite the aura of calm and general lack of danger, I have come here to test the fastest machine we've ever featured on the Gadget Show.
The inventor of that machine is ex-airline and aerobatics pilot Arnold Wagner. 30 years ago, he began building prototypes for a futuristic transport device that took its design direction more from planes than cars. His latest model is the most advanced yet.
This is it. Here we go. Nice gate action.
Oh, nothing here.
Someone's pinched it.
Supposed to.
It's gone, it's been stolen!
But Arnold was just toying with me. He had a grand entrance planned for his machine as it was lowered Hollywood style from the ceiling.
Wow, this is proper Buck Rogers, Star Wars pod racer kind of territory.
Out in the sun, the machine bore more than a passing resemblance to a Tron bike. Its body is a Kevlar bond, and all the steel and tinted glass is top spec.
So come and have a little look inside. Think of this as basically a kind of Swiss Army bike. You've got your Back to the Future-style DeLorean door, very nice. And if you come round and have a little look in here, flux capacitor, got one of those, brilliant. Air conditioning, mini sunroof, and my favourite bit of all, the sleeping compartment, or boot.
But style isn't everything, because over the years on the Gadget Show, we've seen the best-looking personal transport from the pumper bike to the wheel surf literally fall by the wayside when it comes to rideability. So to find out if this two-seater can stay the course, I'm about to be taken for a spin.
We have ignition. OK. Wish me luck!
Oh, my God, OK, that's fine, that's fast enough.
OK, let's not die today.
With a top speed of 150 miles per hour and 0 to 62 in 4.8 seconds, this petrol-driven machine is fast.
Oh, it's like being in a sports car, fighter jet and a motorcycle all at the same time. It's just great.
It also costs over 40 grand.
Come on! Woo!
But if you've got the cash to spare, it's a small price to pay for something that's truly unique and road legal in the UK.
Sorry to stop the action. Just so you know, we've been sort of razzing about here for the last sort of hour, doing all these kind of crazy turns so you can see what it's like. But the people up there in the houses have called the police, so we have to stop.
It was clearly time to leave, so the boys took me to a winding section of road to show me just how well the bike could lean.
Look how close we are to the tarmac. I don't know if you can see this, but you can pick this up. We're so close.
So close, in fact, we actually touched.
OK, I'm in minor shock here. That was some pretty crazy cornering around that bend. And just to show you how far we were going down, this bike is designed to go to lean at about 52 degrees, which is similar to that of a sports bike around a track. But if you look here, what happened, we were leaning so far down, we've taken a big chunk off the fairing. We were really close to the ground there. It was a bit hairy.
The monotracer's enclosed cabin means you can't put your foot down to keep it stable when stopped in traffic. To remedy this, two funky little stabilizer wheels have been built in and can be lowered when needed. Finally, it was my turn to get behind the handlebars. I was taken to the widest, emptiest car park in Switzerland. But it seemed that despite having a car and bike license, they didn't completely trust me with their expensive machine.
In gear, hold the switch, yeah. Release clutch, release switch.
Foot on clutch, in
yes.
Gear.
In gear, release clutch.
So I'm moving and then I release that.
Yeah.
Although the Mono Tracer has similarities to both a car and a motorbike, it's neither one nor the other, which means you have to learn a new way of driving.
Bon voyage. Press the clutch.
Start the engine, and
here
we go.
Hear me roar.
Finally, this was my chance to play it being Han Solo. I was ready to burn some rubber.
Top Gun. Oh, God, I'm rubbish at this. Oh, I had dreams of sort of showing off and being really good. And there's no way I can... Oh, God, I'm not going to tip this over, am I?
With the stabilizers down, it really was hard to drive. And the owners of this valuable piece of kit wouldn't let me put them up. And that meant I never got out of first gear. It appears that to go fast and furious on the Mono Tracer, you'll need a lot of practice, balance, and cash.
Fantastic! I can't believe that they didn't let you take the stabilisers off.
I know, I was gutted.
What was going on with it? It looked like a really elegant piece of kit on the road.
Well, here's
it?
The thing. I reckon once those stabilisers are up and you're whizzing around country roads, great.
Yeah.
But on the, you know, when you're in a car park with the stabilisers down, it's like having two sidecars on your motorcycle with an elephant in each one. You cannot steer it.
It's the most unmaneuverable machine ever designed.
Exactly.
Did you want to just press the button? And
I
the
did.
Wheel? Yeah.
And I said, what happens if I press the button? He said, 50% of the people who just press the button, it'll collapse. However, I have something for you, talking of personal transport,
good.
That you may be interested in, a bit more up your street.
Ooh.
Have a look at these. They're called booster blades.
Ooh.
Kind of like a rollerblade. Just
yes.
Put it on.
Okay.
We'll go outside.
All right.
And see what you think.
Have you got another one?
Just the one.
Nice! I like it.
They come in a pair.
Lovely.
Okay, right. Ready?
Ready.
Pride at stake here. Pond
great,
in case
thanks.
It all goes pear-shaped.
All right.
Okay, now, basically, you've got an inline skate here. But if you lift your leg, you will notice that the skate actually jackknifes, and then you press down in order to get momentum. The chain drives the thingy-me-jig, and you look very stylish.
Do I look
and
really cool? Because I feel incredibly cool.
Yeah.
I'm getting
there. That's it.
He's got
it
there.
That's totally it.
Oh my God! Can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
What was wrong with skates?
Not a lot.
Because they were quite good, weren't they?
Not a lot. You've got to ask yourself why.
Boots with wheels on.
Yeah.
I always felt it was an idea that worked.
Yeah. I know, but you know, designers with too much time on their hands.
No, I agree. But I can actually see, in all seriousness, you know, that this is the kind of thing that once you crack it, you know. They feel like they would go quite quickly.
Well, apparently they go up to 25 miles an
25?
Hour.
25?
25.
Turn me around.
Yeah, come on, let's
You'll have to help me, though.
OK.
Thanks, man.
So I just push you really fast.
Really fast,
25
yeah.
miles
You've got
an
a
hour.
Car. That, now it's working, look. There's your pump right there. Oh!
It's called skiing.
Got it.
It's brilliant.
Time for a short break now, but we'll be right back with the final part of our sports challenge.
Yes, Suzi and I go head-to-head as we compete in three specially chosen events of our very own Gadget Olympics.
Ah!
Welcome back.
Now it's time for the final and deciding part of our sports challenge.
Oh, yeah, Suzi won the first part with the football. We drew on the golf, so it's still all to play for as we move into the final part of our Gadgety Olympics.
Yeah, not the Olympics, though, our Olympics. In fact, our simulated Olympics, because we devised a gadget triathlon.
Yeah, swimming, rowing, and then followed by horse riding, OK? All great Olympic sports in their own right, but even better if they're all gadgety.
For our first Olympic event, gadget swimming, we'd each got a machine that simulates massive swimming distances while you remain on the spot.
I'd got this fast lane current generator.
And I'd got a Vassa ergometer swimming machine.
We'd be starting from the lowest setting and the speed would be cranked up on both machines. Whoever wussed out first, lost.
And we were off.
I'm already swimming on the spot. That's amazing. The fast lane is essentially a treadmill for the water. The 5-horsepower motor sucks water up and spits it back out through hydraulic hoses, creating a current that you swim against.
It's strange. It feels like someone's sort of pushing my chest very gently.
The Vassa ergometer is supposedly even more effective for training than actual swimming. It uses airflow wind resistance to improve endurance, and you can monitor and control the resistance for the left and right arm independently. Useful if one side is stronger than the other.
This is a great swimming aid, and you really feel it on the back of your arms.
OK, they're ramping it up now.
As the settings racked up, so did the resistance, increasing my arm ache. But while I could just slow down, Jason had to swim for his life.
Oh, my God!
The current got faster and faster, till it was like swimming up river in a flood. I just couldn't take it any longer, and I had to quit.
I'm drowning!
It's
incredible!
I think that makes me the winner, but it makes me a really shattered one.
But there'd be no respite.
Next, we were taking on rowing with the best-selling rowing machines in the world.
We had two identical concept twos, endorsed by 5-times Olympic gold hero Sir Steve Redgrave. Its similarity to rowing in water has made it his favourite training aid.
We'd be linked and racing each other over 1 kilometre.
With our feet strapped, our paddle braced, we were ready to go.
The machines were linked together through a laptop which monitored our stroke and speed data, as well as giving us a visual representation of the race. You can also race other rowers worldwide by hooking up over the internet.
We'll put the pressure on now.
In our head-to-head race, Jason pulled away from me with every stroke, but I tried desperately to pull it back. The no-impact nature of rowing makes it a great exercise, but not necessarily an easy one, and I just couldn't catch him.
In the end, I crossed the line in 4 minutes 23. Not a moment too soon.
I finished 21 seconds later, but I was too exhausted to care.
Really interesting task.
It was 1-1 with just the final challenge to play for, and that was a horse riding endurance test.
But this was gadget horse riding, and that meant horse riding fitness machines, the eye joyride and the eye gallop.
Here we go.
Oh, my Lord, no!
While these two machines may look hilarious, they offer a serious core workout. Both work in the same way, moving in 3 different ways at 4 different speeds, mimicking the movements of a horse, toning your butt, abs and thighs as you try and maintain balance.
What am I supposed to be doing with my stomach muscles?
Well, you're just keeping it upright, so you're keeping balanced.
We quickly ramped the speed up to gallop, which offers the hardest workout.
Ready?
Here we go.
This was supposed to be an endurance race, but it became a farce.
Be utterly ridiculous! But I know I don't look it.
It's pretty good, actually. Although, obviously, nowhere near anything like being on a real horse. Because a horse has got a brain.
Whoa.
And can be reminiscent of a naughty child. I don't know whether that reminds you of anyone.
We really started to feel the burn, but the only thing we had to endure was how ridiculous we looked.
In the end, we both decided to call it quits and walk away with what little dignity we could salvage.
I'm sorry, this is just so ridiculously funny.
Well, obviously, that dissolved into a complete farce, so we'll call the Olympics a draw.
Whoa!
Down, steady.
Whoa, it's a draw, but you win the challenge, yeah?
Yeah, thank you, because of the football.
Yeah.
Woohoo!
Oh.
Now, regarding these...
Yes, are they realistic? I've never been on a real horse, so I couldn't tell you.
Well, I do ride, and I don't think they're that realistic, actually. You do need to have some stirrups to put your feet in, but probably quite good for your core muscles.
So nice as a training aid, but...
Yeah, but if you
want to
ride a horse, go get on a
get
horse.
Get a horse. OK, well, we're going to gallop off into the sunset now.
Oh, okay.
It's the end of this week's show. We'll see you next time. Come on.
Ready?
On the fastest, let's go.
OK, we go. Good night.